Hi, welcome to my channel, the Machine Learning Engineer. In today's video, we will continue with the MLOps series and we will see an introduction to post estimation algorithms. Post estimation algorithms are an area of computer vision which essentially involves detect and track the position and orientation of objects. Typically humans, but not only that, it could be also animals, robots, and anything that you may need to detect the position and the orientation of the object. And this is done either in videos or in images and videos. The technique is widely used in the industry and for many purposes: augmented reality, location, positional location, in many industries like healthcare, sports, or others. The goal here is the goal of this post estimation technique is to detect the location and orientation of parts or body parts, in case that we are working with human bodies or animal bodies, body parts like joints and limbs. We know this as key point. You can see here in the picture the key points here: the shoulders, the knees, the elbows, every algorithm had defined in their architecture a number of key points to detect, and then this is what composed the what we name as a skeleton. And as I said, the idea is to detect into the image and therefore later on the video the skeleton, the key points that form this object into the figure. For that there is different techniques. And essentially there is main classes of post estimation algorithms. The 2D post estimation, which try to identify these key points in 2D images. This again here ahead, the shoulders, elbows, knees in a 2D dimension. So we got the final prediction is if our algorithm, let's say, had 15 different key points to predict, the output of the algorithm will be, in the simple case that we just had an object on the picture, it will be 15 different coordinates with two dimensions. The second class is 3D, obviously post estimation. In this case, the output of this algorithm is a vector, in this case, of 15 as well key points, but with an additional coordinate, which give us a richer object spatial orientation. These 3D are particularly useful in robotics and animation. What more? Let me show you here. Here we have an example of what I'm talking about. You can see here this algorithm, for example. As I said, different algorithms have different numbers of key points, and then when you provide you have a map of these key points, and you have also maps of the relationships in between the different key points. This is orientated to track position and orientation of the different key points across the different frames. This is obviously used when you have to identify the temporal relationships in between the different key points across the time we are working with videos in that case. But you can see here is we had the head here, the neck, the shoulders, the wrists, the knees, etc. So this, what you see here, is the skeleton we had, and in this case the algorithm had 17 different key points. So the objective in case of working out with a 2D or 3D is just to predict, in this case, 17 key points with two coordinates or three coordinates depending on how we design the model. This can become much more complicated. So this is the skeleton-based model. There is other which use contours. Here we use additionally other techniques like segmentation and others where we try to the prediction in this case is not simply 17, like in the case that we saw before, the 17 key points that define the skeleton. Here we define a sequence of key points in two dimensions or three dimensions. We form the contour of the object that we want to track and estimate the position. And there is even a more complicated, more complex algorithms with we detect the volume, which essentially is detect not only the contours, it's not the different layers. We are providing an additional coordinate here and an additional dimension where we not only define the contour, it also define the position or the volume of that specific point. So those algorithms are quite complex, very intensive, very computational intensive resource, those ones. And then today we are going to see a couple of examples of the skeleton based mode. Well, what more, the apart of the classification in two dimensions, three dimensions, there is other perspective how to classify these algorithms. It is a single person or multi-person. Single person today is practically no use, unless that you are doing something very particular. For example, you want to compare the position of a person doing some sport training, and you want to compare a professional or a good training with a training done by a student or a person who tried to learn how to do some exercise. And then usually those algorithms are more today multi-person, because also, obviously you can apply, you can use a multi-person algorithm for a single case, no, for a case with where you have only a person on the image or the video. So for the single person, that was how this problem was approached at the beginning. As I mentioned, this is a quite mature technique into the computer vision area. The single person, essentially try to determine where is the person in the image, and then on we try to determine the number of key points that we had defined for the algorithm. When we extend this to the multi-person, like we have in this other picture I show you here, essentially we do the same for all the objects we had on the frame. What happened here, there is a part of detecting, as you can imagine, we have to determine first of all how many objects of those that we want to track are on the image, and then on localize the key points of that different objects. For this we had two different approaches. The first is the top-down approach, where we first localize the different objects of the class that we want to track on the frame. We localize them into the image, and after that we run an algorithm to determine the pose of every individual object localized on the image. So the first phase maybe is usually a phase of the segmentation, where you essentially localize. In this case, if you are working, you want to apply this for human bodies, you apply segmentation and localize all the humans on the screen, and then apply to those segments the to those objects detected the post estimation algorithm. This this approach is usually known as top down. The bottom up is the opposite. First of all, you localize or all the key points on the image, and then you group them into human bodies, like in this case. All these techniques, as we are in the area of computer vision, usually is a pile of tracks of convolutional layers, which produce a feature map. And then on, as I said before, after this feature map, you can start to creating apply segmentation techniques to localize the object that you want to track, or you can create what they say head maps of key points, and then on after local after create the head maps of key points, you group them into objects, like in this case into persons. There is other some of the algorithms as well produce what we know as PAPS, pairwise relations, pairwise relation vectors, where essentially establish the relation in between one key point and others that they had close, or the others that had been detecting close to it. For example, this key point relation with this one, or this one, also with the others. But what we try to determine is how this limb is moving or changing across the time, obviously in case of we are working with video. And again, at the end, all these algorithms, especially those that are based in deep learning, in computer vision techniques, are, as I said, a pile of convolutional layers, different the models, the different architectures that are we had already available. Vary essentially in different features. For example, how many key points you want to predict, what is the technique, it is a simple single object or multiple object detection algorithm, it is it are following a top-down approach or a bottom-up. So depending how you build the algorithm, you need to compose the different pieces of the architecture and establish relationships in between them. As well, if the algorithm is going to be used for images or video, because you also need to detect different relations, either spatial or temporal, not only of the individual key points, also of the relations in between the different key points that form a skeleton. But at the end, you will need to apply the different boxes, different components, common as well on the computer vision, like segmentation and object detection and others. Okay, let's return to the there is different architecture, well-known architecture. Today we will see only two. You have OmniPose, as you say there. Different architecture, how they combine the different components of the pipeline, after producing the feature maps, there is different components which essentially refine and find the different skeletons of objects in the image and the different key points of the image. OmniPoise is well known, really well known and very efficient algorithm. You have also MMPose from OpenMMLab, also very well known algorithm. I will put you all the, this is really, it's worthy to take a look to these guys, really impressive what they do. You have also a version using Vision Transformers. We will do a separate video with this because I want to do also some other stuff. We had one of the ones that we are going to see today con, is available on the OpenBinomial Model Zoo, multi-person 3D human pose estimation with this combination of different techniques, OpenPose, which is the, essentially the base of the OmniPose, but OmniPose is applied to multiple objects, and also a single shot multi-person 3D pose detection. In the single shot is just used in a single shot like we do in LLMs, zero shot, no, single shot detection of the objects, doing essentially with the segmentation. And the other one that we will see today, oops, I need to reconnect this to show you, is the MoveNet architecture from Google, and yeah, well, this is really very efficient as well, one of the most popular architectures today, essentially because apart of being very precise, well, they had different versions that even run, as you can see, in TensorFlow Lite, which are modern designs to run in smartphones or embedded devices. So today, again, I have prepared, like in other occasions, a notebook, and also we will take directly the notebook that Google provide from in their documentation, because well, we don't need to reinvent the wheel, we just need to look at how we can use it. Most of them, well, they are really simple to use. You just the most complicated here is just you don't want to train something with your particular object, obviously. If you just want to use one and to create an application, the most complicated of this is not to use the algorithm, obviously, it's just to, you just take it and do inference, is later on to draw the different objects predicted into the image, no? So for those, usually we take we infer or use some other algorithms directly produce a vector with this pairwise relations in between key points, and then we just need to use them in combination with the key points maps to draw the skeleton on top of the image. And this is the probably the most complicated part of the logic once you simply want to use one of these algorithms. In this introduction, we are going just to use them, and then in the next video we will go a little bit more deeper to fine tune one of the algorithms and also use the BitPose, which is a different technique where we are using here transformers. You are following the channel, you saw that we did a couple of videos explaining the technology for video classification, and also for image classification and for video classification. There is an extension, is at the end of the day to do like in any others. When you are working with computer vision, to extend from image to video is just, well, infer from the video the relationships, the temporal relationships in between the different feature maps that produces for every single frame. And when we do here the same in determine the pose in a video is exactly the same. When you are working in classification, you have a linear layer at the end of the architecture. In this case, instead to have a linear layer, we have another kind of layer with instead to produce a vector of 10 classes like we did in the previous video, provide a vector with for example, if you had in the example I explained at the beginning, fit 10 different key points in 3 dimensions, you get a vector of 15 key points with 3 coordinates, that is the head. It's a head prepared to detect to produce that specific output. But the different layers, there is a common group of layers, which obviously as well vary depending on the architecture, how you define it. But we had a number of the convolutional layers with different kernels, different filters, which produce the feature maps. And from there, we on top of this stack of convolutional layers, we post other different components to produce, in some cases, a classification, or in this case, feature or head maps of key points where you later can map into an object. Okay, let's go to the today's talk. Later I will upload this notebook, the two notebooks to the repository as usual. The first thing that you will need to do is to install the libraries. If you are following the channel, you probably have some of the videos that I already did working with OpenBINO. We had a number of them on the channel. So if you had already the environment, you just need to install the PY3GS and the OpenBINO DevTools. It's not, well, the main, I'm working in my local computer today. We are going to do inference in the CPU, so you may need to install. I'm working in a Conda environment with JupyterLab, so to replicate exactly what you are seeing on the screen, you probably just need to, well, to follow this requirements txt is essentially the libraries that you see here. We install the OpenBINO and ONNX and Torch with the CPU compatibility. We don't need the GPU compatibility for those libraries. The most important is the OpenBINO DevTools, because now we are going to convert the original PyTorch model, the one that we are going to use for OpenBINO model 2, which is this one. I downloaded human pose estimation 3D. It's a 3D obviously model. We will convert it to ONNX, and after that we will convert it into IR format, the proprietary format of OpenBINO, in order to do inference on the CPU efficiently. As you probably remember, first of all, we are not going to do quantization, so we are going to use floating point 32 to do as a data type for the our weight, so we don't change it. We don't change them. One second. Sorry. We will download the original model is already pre-trained, so we are not going to do any additional personalization. We just going to use it. We will convert it first of all to ONNX with the OpenVINO runtime, OpenVINO toolkit, and then I'll convert it to this conversion is just simply transform the format, as we don't do quantization as well. There is no practically no change on the size of the model. You can see here is practically nothing, 200 key. The model itself is not very big, and when we transform the model to IR format, also it's not changing. It's just compressing, but well, the difference, the compression ratio here, as we are keeping the data type the same precision, also is not practically not nothing, no, not appreciable. Okay, so once you have all the requirements and your environment ready, let's say we can start to do the conversion. So it's very important to have the OpenVINO DevTools correctly installed, because it's not you will not be able. You can download the model from the OpenVINO model soup, but the conversion, if you don't have the OpenVINO runtime and the DevTools set up correctly, you will not be able to do it. In that case, if you have any issues, let me know. Write me on the channels. On YouTube, on the YouTube channel in this video, in the comments, and then I will try to help you out. Well, before we continue, the model itself is, as I mentioned, is having an input of an image of the three channels with 256 height, 448 width, and the output is a feature vector with 57 coordinates in a three-dimensional space, and head maps, key point head maps, we obtain 19 key points, and we obtain the paps, that are par affinity fields. So how are the relation in between the different key points detected for that specific frame. Okay, let's move back. Oh, sorry, I had to be here. So first of all, we simply download the model. For the model, essentially here on the notebook, we are calling to the ONC downloader, which is part of the DevTools of the OpenVINO runtime. Again, this you can download it. Here is not only download it, it's also converting the ONC downloader, download and convert the PyTorch into ONNX. So after running this command, you should have this and this model. No, sorry. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. What more? Once you have the model converted into ONNX, I repeat, here we download the model only, we download the PyTorch model. This part, I'm messing everything around. So here we download the model, This part is just download the PyTorch model, and this part is converting this part. If you don't have correctly installed the DevTools, you can do it manually, because it's just simply download the PyTorch model. I will put a link into the notebook just to case that you are unable, but at the end you had to do the conversion using this a command I put you here. This is the one I use on the command line, which is essentially the same that is executing this one back here on the Jupyter Lab notebook. We get the device, determine which device, as we install PyTorch without the CUDA support. We only are able to use the CPU, and then on we will read now here the model in ONN format, on ONNX format, and compile the model to be used in a CPU. That is the thing that we are doing here. Then on we create in this variable an instance of the create and infer request to do later on the inference in the methods that we are going to detect the different key maps. And here you get the import tensor name. This is part of the parameters that we need to do the inference, and you have here input layer and output layer and an example. You can see here the input layer is that one. You have a save, as we saw in the documentation, three channels, height and width, and then on the output is gonna be features map, head maps, and paths. Okay, so now we had some additional methods that we had here. We had the body edge maps. This is the key points. This is the paths, or the relations in between. This is this maps we use it to draw the poses on top of every single frame. In the model inference, we just simply get the scaled image, the straight of the window, which is essentially the part of the window that is just relevant, and the function to infer, this that we create here. This is just a copy of the compile model inference method. And we essentially make an scale it. Well, we took some part of the image, taking into consideration the stride, and we just transpose the object, and we pass the object for inference, and from the result obtained, we split it in the three different vectors. Now we had here a method to essentially run the inference on top of a video. We have here essentially in the video way, in this method, we create a video player object which essentially will take either the camera or a video file, and it will split the input in different frames. To every single frame, we will rescale the image. We will rescale the image. Here we are just initializing the engine to show the video in the notebook, and here in that place we essentially, where is this scale exactly? Here we are just doing some calculations to resizing the frame, etc., to finally send the image for inference. And then once we had the results, as you remember, here are the three vectors, and with the three vectors we had here, we use the this other method, the parsePose, to produce these other vectors. Here we are just passing the inference result, and as I said, parsePose is a specific method of the engine, that we are using. Engine 3GS is a method that essentially will take the output of the inference, the model inference, and will draw the different the skeleton or the different object detected into in these three vectors that we obtain here. Once we had there, we just had some other logic to just draw the lines, the key points, the limbs, and some text case that we are producing in top of the image. Okay. So here we have just the final test. We can do, let's do a couple of tests with this algorithm. We are not going to use the camera. You can see here we had a special this is done everything by the 3GS engine. So it's creating this spatial representation, and we have here the equivalent, the video, original video, and then you can see here the skeletons moving in the spatial representation. This spatial representation from some videos are not fully well represented, especially if they are not MP4 format, because the parameters that we have specified are for some specific resolution. If you are below them, they are not working very well. We need to adapt them. Let's do a second example, and you will see here that with this GIF. Sometimes take a while all the data is processed and parsed and copied and to the engine. That's why it sometimes it take a while, depending on the size of the video and the number of frames you had. It may take a little bit of time. Okay, so this is what I mentioned you before. Depending on the dimensions of the frames, we will need to adapt, or you will need to adapt the parameters of the reproduction engine. And the other one you have here. You can see here also the effect. This algorithm is using a top-down approach. So first of all, is detecting the objects, and then on detecting the pose, and then on these objects, these algorithms essentially, well, they used to be slower than the bottom top, but they are really more efficient. Once they have an object detected, it keeps track of the object across the whole video. They are very effective. They use not to fail Okay, let's move now to moving it. Okay. I just had to run all the files again. As let's go here. As you can see, we had different versions of the model. Movenet, as I mentioned you, in this case the model detected 17 different key points. It's very effective. You can check here, and you will see later how it's working with the video. It's, we had two variants. The lifting and thunder. Lifting is designed for speed, thunder for accuracy, and you have different versions. These are 32 floating point, 16 and integer 8. These quantized versions are designed for to run in TensorFlow Lite library, which essentially is the library that they designed to run in mobile devices or embedded devices. So here you may see the input size vary depending on the version of the model that you are going to use. And also, well, the output is always the same. You get a vector with one channel, three channels and 17 game points. It's as simple as that. Then on, well, here we do first example. And you can see here the image detected, and you had there the 70 key points detected on the image. For video, it's a little bit more complicated. We need to define the region or try to identify the region where the object is, just to optimize essentially where we need to focus, or where the algorithm needs to focus to detect the different key points. So I'll take a look in your environment here. As I mentioned before, the most complicated logic is just to draw the skeletons on the images. You may spend hours to use create the logic to do this, but well, the output, the final output, is quite now we are just visualizing. Now here we are also using CPU, and again the here, well, you may think that it's taking more time, but it's because we are just simply creating the GIF at the same time. After running the inference, we are creating the GIF. It's also introducing some delays. But you can see essentially all the algorithms, even having different architectures, run very efficiently. The most as well, or probably complicated at the beginning, the initial decision is first of all determine for what you want to use the algorithm. What is your final goal? Is you just want to track a single object, multiple objects? What you want to do? It is going to be a video. It's going to be individual images, because you may, for example, you are tracking the movements of a robot, and then you probably want to do only image by image. You don't need to so you only need to keep to control what the robot is doing in two or three specific positions. You don't need to control all the how to say movements of the or all the positions of the arm while he's moving. You just are interested in the moment that the what is the position of the arm when this arm is taking an object, and then on another frame when the arm is depositing or putting the object in top of a electric line which is going to carry the object to another position. So depending what is your objective, the initial decision of which algorithm you want to take, it is an algorithm. You want to compare the position of the human body when you are doing some training, or where somebody is dancing, or when somebody is doing an Olympic sport, and then you may need to do a video and choose a different approach. If you, for example, are tracking how a football team is working in a team during or train different techniques or different combinations when the team is defending, or where the team is in offensive. In an offensive maneuver, you may need to use, you will probably need to use a different algorithm depending what is your final goal. But yeah, this is the decision of what you want to do is going to is marked, no, or driven by the requirements of your. Or your business or your project goals. That's pretty much all. Very interesting topic as well as everything that we see today. Whatever we look at, there is really interesting stuff. I will now upload these videos. This you can get it essentially from Google, but anyway, I will put a copy on the repository, and you will be able to download everything from there. And as well, this one I just created with the other model we use, the 3D human pose. Multi-person 3D human pose. There is multiple examples, multiple demos. Also, you had demos available here in OmniPose, in MM Pose. So there is everywhere. Take a look, and then just if you want to get introduced into this topic, which is really interesting, really complex at the same time. The plan as well is to do in the next video, when we continue with this topic, to use the visual transformer, visual transformer, and with additional components to do post detection and to do a personalization of that model. We will do this in a separate video because this is gonna take hours, and then no way to somebody watch up to the end. That is the final objective. Again, thank you very much if you watch the video up to this point. I hope that you find it interesting and it was useful for you, for your training, for whatever reason are you watching these videos. And if so, just give me a like, subscribe to the channel, and if you are not already subscribed, and make comments case that you had any issue, obviously, if not also make any comments how you find it, and share with your friends if somebody you think that they may need just to help me to grow in YouTube. Thank you very much and see you soon.